Good evening. I'm John Nico, the executive director of the Ely Legacy Foundation. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to Jack Templeton Liberty Series program tonight here at beautiful Liberty Hill. I want to thank our hosts, Sean Palmer, Michelle Gentile, and the whole staff here. They do a wonderful job, and I hope you're all staying for lobster night. It should be spectacular, almost as spectacular as our speaker, Joe Loconte. So Legacy Foundation, of course, is the nonprofit charity of the Union League of Philadelphia. We use the history, the values, the spirit of this great institution, the Union League of Philadelphia, for a whole range of different programs, all focused on that first line of your bylaws, the Union League bylaws. Every member shall support the Constitution and the free enterprise system. We do this for scholarship programs, exhibits, the care of a great Civil War collection, and through civics education. And it's in civics education that we really want to make a big difference and focus. We have a lot of plans in the coming months and years. They're big plans. They're going to need your support. Part of those plans are to partner with other like-minded organizations. I want to take a moment just to recognize one of them. I know Tom Kelly, who's at the Jack Miller Center, is here with us somewhere here. Jack Miller and the Legacy Foundation will be partnering on Civic Summit this coming November. Over 200 leading civics education providers, organizations, policymakers will be at the Union League to see what we can do to make a difference and recover civics education in our nation. So we're going to need your support for a lot of that. I look forward to that. Everything we do is made possible through voluntary contributions, mostly from Union League members. So if you haven't yet given, we've just started our fiscal year, so I'll assume most of you have not yet. Please consider a contribution to the Legacy Foundation. I also want to introduce two of our leaders of the Legacy Foundation. We have a great group of leaders that volunteer their time, talent, and treasure to our mission. And I wanted to introduce Jeff Denton and Steve Parkett, members of our Legacy Foundation board. Thank you. Thank you. A few housekeeping items. So before I do that, we just published the fall calendar. It is a fantastic series of lectures and programs, the first of which is actually September 18th, and it's a kickoff to the year. It's a celebration, if you will. It's a look forward. If you haven't received an invitation, all you need to do is talk to Kristen Moran, and she'll tell you how much you have to contribute to get an invitation to this great event. But please consider coming to this event on September 18th. A few housekeeping items. Please silence your cell phones. Take a moment to do that, please, if you haven't already. Tonight's program will be about 40 minutes, plus a little bit of Q&A. We will do the Q&A with the microphones. So please use the microphones. We're streaming live. We need you to use those. And remember, and we had a problem with this before the program in June, it's a question, a couple sentences, and if it's not in the form of a question, you have failed. So please, we're looking for questions for Joe to answer. So our speaker tonight is no stranger to the Legacy Foundation. He's been a speaker at several Liberty Series programs, Library Hours. He's been a main speaker and presenter at our Liberty Week.
That's right. Thanks, brother. Yeah. Picking on my New York Mets. All right, can you hear me out there in the bleacher seats? How are we doing out there? Good. Terrific. Thank you all for coming tonight. I just think it's amazing, and I'm so encouraged by so many people who care about things that matter and make the investment in time to do that, and that Union League Legacy Foundation makes it possible. A round of applause for these guys, for yourselves. I'm just so impressed. Thank you for coming. So the question we put out there was, Western civilization, is it worth defending? And just a little preview, Loconte vigorously defends his course on Western civilization against his critics, which are legion, okay? Legion. That's like, that's a little joke, you know, legion, okay? That's all. All right, so let's get into it. We're in London, in the House of Commons, June 18th, 1940, and Great Britain is at war again. The British Prime Minister is about to deliver a speech that will help to determine the fate of democracy and freedom in the West. This is the speech that will save Western civilization. Now, that claim is going to sound outrageous to a lot of you. How could one man's speech rescue a civilization from disaster? How could a man's words prevent the ultimate catastrophe? Is such a thing even possible? Let's find out. The chamber is filled to capacity on June 18, 1940, when Prime Minister Winston Churchill rises to address the House and the nation. Now, the day before, on June 17th, France had surrendered to Nazi Germany. France, which had given its lifeblood to counter German aggression in the First World War. France, which had possessed the largest army on the continent at the start of the war. France succumbs. The defeat of France was the culmination of a series of defeats for the Western democracies. Think about it. In March of 1939, Germany absorbed the state of Czechoslovakia. In September, Hitler invades Poland, the event that, of course, triggered the Second World War. April of 1940, Germany invades Denmark and Norway, overwhelming them in a matter of days. In May, the Nazis sweep into Belgium and Holland, bombing Rotterdam to rubble. By May 15th, German panzers pierce the Maginot Line in northern France, and so 300,000 British and French troops are forced to evacuate the continent at Dunkirk. In the words of Winston Churchill, it is a colossal military disaster. So, the Germans control every major European capital. They control the ports. They have mastery in the air. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the geopolitical situation when Winston Churchill addresses the House of Commons, June 18th, 1940. I think what this moment represents is a contest between civilization, the civilization of the West, and barbarism. That's what this moment represents, civilization versus barbarism. But the democratic leaders of the West are completely unprepared for this war. The previous British government, led by Neville Chamberlain, guided by a policy of appeasement, had ignored the gathering storm. British politicians are now calling for an inquest to assess blame. Who do we blame for this catastrophe? Winston Churchill will have none of it. In his speech before the House, he condemns this impulse as, quote, a foolish and pernicious process. Then he goes on, of this I'm quite sure. If we open up a quarrel between the past and the present, we shall find that we have lost the future. We're going to come back to Churchill's speech before we're done, I promise. But I want to draw our attention to his warning to the House. If we open a quarrel between the past and the present, we shall find that we have lost the future. Something is happening today in the West. I think we all sense it, especially in the United States, which none of us has seen in our lifetimes. We have opened up a quarrel with our past. Now, what do I mean? I don't mean that we're reevaluating and criticizing our history, highlighting the acts of injustice that are part of the record. Historians have been doing that for a long time. No, friends, we have opened up a fundamental argument with our past. Our educators, lawmakers, filmmakers, journalists, pundits, the knowledge class, they have come to regard our inherited beliefs, values, institutions as illegitimate. The concept of the human family, for example, sanctity of life, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, the separation of powers, the rule of law, government by consent of the governed. All of these ideas, if you think about it, they're under assault. 80 years ago, Great Britain and the Democratic West, they faced an existential crisis, right? I don't know if we face an existential crisis now, but it is a crisis of confidence, a lack of civilizational confidence. Western civilization, we are told, is a conceit. It's no better than any other civilization, probably worse. To the political left, the folks on the hard left, our traditional beliefs and institutions are just a social construction, right? Tools of the oppressor against the oppressed. The history of the United States, they say, is a story of racism from beginning to end. But it's not just the radical left that rejects our democratic inheritance. I think we got to be honest about this. There are voices on the right who argue that the American founders, they gave us a political society steeped in sin from its birth. Not so much the sin of slavery. That's not what they have in mind. It's the Enlightenment ideas about human freedom, equality, and natural rights. The new right is impatient with constitutional government. That's a problem. Now, what unites, I think, the political left and the political right today is a stunning lack of gratitude. Gratitude. Gratitude for our remarkable achievements in promoting human freedom. We have opened up a quarrel with our past. And if we don't do something about it, we're going to lose the future. So, what follows is one man's modest attempt to try to do something about it. Now, my students at Western Civ, those who survived my Western Civ class, and God bless them, they know that my approach is to deal frankly with the good, the bad, and the ugly. Usually I start my class out with a little film clip from that great spaghetti Western with, you know, Clint Eastwood, the good, the bad, and the ugly, right? Great soundtrack. Well, no competent historian can be ignorant of the bad and the ugly, but at the same time, no honest historian can ignore the good and the noble. A year before he died, after a long and distinguished career at Oxford and Cambridge universities, C.S. Lewis, he wrote to his friend J.R.R. Tolkien, revealing his debt to Tolkien. Here's what Lewis said to Tolkien. All of my philosophy of history hangs upon a sentence of your own. What? His whole philosophy of history on one sentence from C.S. Lewis? What sentence? It's a sentence from Lord of the Rings. We got any hobbits out there? Closet hobbits? Just curious. I knew he had a few hobbits. Great. This is when Gandalf explains to Frodo something of the ancient struggle for Middle Earth. Here's the line. There was sorrow then too, and gathering dark, but great valor and great deeds that were not wholly vain. I want to reflect together on the achievements of the West, the acts of courage and valor that have shaped our civilization and our world for the better. Now, when we talk about the West and Western civilization, just I want to do real quickly, friends, and just shout it out, a word association. When you hear Western civilization, just tell me one word or two words, what comes to your mind, an image, something, word association. What's that? Anna Smith, great.
Freedom.
Freedom, baby, yeah. Democracy, what else? What was that? Greece, of course, Greece, thank you. Christianity, great. Wonderful answers. This crowd, you guys are all right. You guys are doing fine, great. Western Civ, let me give you a quick working definition. It's the centuries-long interaction between Greek and Roman culture, right? Transformed by Judaism and Christianity, right? Adopted, transformed, and then transformed again by the intellectual, scientific, political revolutions of the 17th and 18th centuries in Europe and the United States. That's Western Civ, all right, in a nutshell. What we want to do tonight is try to figure out, all right, what's distinctive about our civilization? Three things we're going to talk about. Number one, the use of reason in the pursuit of truth. Reason. In the pursuit of truth. Two, the bond between natural law and natural rights. And then three, the belief in a loving God on a rescue mission for mankind. That's the big picture tonight, guys, as I take a sip of water here. Okay, hang on there. Okay, the use of reason in the pursuit of truth. Imagine we're in a courtroom in Athens, 399 BC, where a 70-year-old man is on trial for his life. Now, for the better part of three decades, this guy has dominated the intellectual life of Athens as a philosopher, as an agitator, as a provocateur. His name, of course, is Socrates. Socrates is accused of impiety against the gods and of corrupting the youth of Athens. How is he corrupting the youth of Athens? He's teaching them to think, to think. He knows full well if he's found guilty, he's going to be sentenced to death. But Socrates doesn't give an inch. Listen to a few lines from Socrates. Someone will say, "Are you not ashamed, Socrates, of a course of life which is likely to bring you to an untimely end?" To him, I may fairly answer, "There you are mistaken. A man who is good for anything ought not to calculate the chance of living or dying. He ought only to consider whether in doing anything he is doing right or wrong, acting the part of a good man or of a bad." Well, what happens? You know what happens. The jury of Athens deliberates. They find Socrates guilty. He's given a choice: permanent exile or death by poison. He doesn't get the option of hanging out at the golf course over here playing 18 rounds. It is permanent exile or death by poison. He chooses death. He drinks the hemlock. So what's the enduring legacy of Socrates? Why do we remember this guy a couple of millennia later? His legacy is his willingness to die for an idea. What idea? The right to think. The right to use reason in the pursuit of truth. Come, let us reason together, God implores the Jewish people at a crisis moment in their history. Human reason to discover truths about the world that God has made. This idea, friends, it instigates one of the most important revolutions in the history of the world. Yes, the scientific revolution. Now, there were other sophisticated societies outside of the West, but they did not generate communities of scientists or produce observations that qualify as science. China, for example, was a very civilized culture relative to Europe for many centuries. But the Chinese, with their philosophy of Confucianism, they failed to develop science. Muslim scholars possessed almost the whole corpus of the Greco-Roman world. They made advances in mathematics, but under the influence of the Islamic worldview, they did not become scientists. Science did not arise in India, Egypt, or in the Middle East. Why? The curious person wants to know why. If science involves a rational effort to explain natural phenomena, if it's a process of developing theories and testing them, then this enterprise arose only once, friends, in the history of mankind. The award-winning historian Edward Grant put it this way: "It is indisputable that modern science emerged in the 17th century in Western Europe and nowhere else." Still the question, why? Well, I think an important part of the answer is simply this: it's the Bible. The influence of the biblical tradition in the West, the belief in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, a God who was rational and purposeful, who made the world out of nothing distinct from himself. The leaders of medieval Europe, Catholic Europe, they believed that God had written two books, friends. Yes, the book of Scripture, the Bible, but also the book of nature. The book of Scripture and the book of nature, and God is glorified by the study of both. Here in the West, and only here, science becomes a sacred calling. The philosopher Alfred North Whitehead, 100 years ago at Harvard, he stuns his colleagues at Harvard because he tells them that Christianity was responsible for the scientific revolution in the West. Here's what he said: "I'm not talking about the beliefs of a few people. What I mean is the impress of the European mind arising from the unquestioned faith of centuries. The scientific revolution of the 17th century depended in part, yes, on breakthroughs from earlier generations of thinkers. Isaac Newton put it beautifully: if I have seen further than most, it's because I'm a midget standing on the shoulders of giants." I love that line, Loconte the midget, standing on the shoulders of giants. But men like Galileo, Newton, and Copernicus, they had to go beyond these earlier thinkers. They had to be willing to challenge conventional wisdom. And that took courage, friends. That took guts. The scientific revolution launched in the West, think about it, it has brought incredible blessings to the rest of the world in medicine, in agriculture, in the technologies that have helped countless millions of people escape lives of squalor, disease, and despair. Plato is my friend and Aristotle is my friend, Newton said, but my greatest friend is truth. So the use of reason in the pursuit of truth. That's one distinctive of the West. A second distinctive. The concept of natural law and natural rights as the foundation of a political society. Now, don't panic. We're not going to get too philosophical here. Number one, Loconte here. I'm the great-grandson of a baker, the grandson of a barber, and the son of an Eggman from Brooklyn. We don't do philosophy in the Loconte family. So you can relax. We're not going to get too philosophical. When I say natural rights, natural law, just think about those beautiful lines from the Declaration. You know, we hold these truths to be self-evident. That's what we mean by natural law, natural rights. We'll get to it. So hang in there. It's important. All right. Until recently, we used to take natural law, this idea of natural, a universal moral law, we used to take it for granted. Okay, hobbits. Remember that exchange between Aragorn and Eomer in The Lord of the Rings? As they're coming to grips with the growing threat of Mordor. How is a man to judge what to do in such times, asks Eomer. As he has ever judged, says Aragorn. Good and evil have not changed since yesteryear, nor are they one thing among elves and another thing among men. It is a man's part to discern them. That, friends, is natural law, universal moral law. J.R.R. Tolkien, like C.S. Lewis, they were immersed in the literary canon of the West. But let's go back a little further. Go back to Rome's greatest statesman, Marcus Tullius Cicero. Cicero explained in the Republic that something other than the whims of the gods was at work in the world, a moral law of divine origin woven into human nature. Listen to a few lines from Cicero on this. There will not be one such law in Rome and another in Athens, one now and another in the future, but all peoples at all times will be embraced by a single, eternal, unchangeable law. And there will be, as it were, one Lord and master of us all, the God who is the author, proposer, and interpreter of the law. That's a Roman guy talking about universal moral law, natural law. Accessible to everyone, right? If you think about it, it's behind the Ten Commandments in some ways. Don't steal, right? Don't bear false witness. Don't kill, right? Natural law, you could argue, lies behind the teachings of Jesus. Think about his parables. His challenge to repentance would have been unintelligible to people who had no sense of right or wrong, no sense they had violated the moral law, right? So this concept of natural law, moral law, this is going to be important now, friends, as the Roman Empire collapses. And what's left standing when the Roman Empire collapses? The church, the Catholic Church, the Catholic Christian Church helps to build a new society on the ruins of Rome. And natural law is going to be a big part of that. Thomas Aquinas will help to transform the law and the culture of ancient Europe, beginning around the 13th century, the Golden Rule. Treat your neighbor as you want to be treated. The Golden Rule is being applied now for the first time to political life, to law. Individuals now, regardless of their class, their tribe, their ethnicity, they will be protected under a new legal system. That begins to happen now, again, by the 12th, 13th century. There are setbacks, as there almost always are in history. Setbacks, right? Medieval Europe, for all of its achievements, which are remarkable, fails to make the protection of our natural rights the purpose of government. Shouldn't government be dedicated to it? They're not thinking that way yet. But by the 16th century, the overriding issue in Europe, in Christendom, is the right of individual conscience in matters of faith. This is Martin Luther's most revolutionary act in his defiance at the Diet of Worms, 1521. Controversial guy, I know. But one thing Luther does is he elevates the individual believer armed with the Bible and his or her conscience above any earthly authority. Listen to Luther. My conscience is captive to the word of God. I will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Here I stand. So what does the Protestant Reformation do? It does a lot, but one of the fundamental things it does, it transforms the relationship between the individual and the state. Yes, friends, Protestants could be as intolerant of dissent as their Catholic counterparts, but the Reformation changes things. It sets a new template. In Western Europe now, for the first time in the 17th century, the sanctity of individual conscience in the pursuit of truth, it launches a series of debates over natural rights. What are these natural rights? Who has them? How do we protect them? Now the debate starts in one place only. It's here in the West, 16th century into the 17th. And like nowhere else in the world, the concepts of natural law, universal natural law, and natural rights will come together. And the guy who's at the tip of the spear, English philosopher John Locke, is going to lead the revolution. My students know, because I'm kind of a John Locke scholar, they know, no matter what kind of conversation we're having, we can be talking about the New York Mets, within about 30 seconds, we're talking about John Locke, you know? Just kind of my guy. Locke's my guy. So bear with me, guys. All right. His breakthrough is to insist that a government is only legitimate if it protects our fundamental natural rights. That's Locke's big thing. Government loses its legitimacy if it doesn't protect our fundamental rights. Locke does something no one else has done. He's 100 years now before the American founders. He's in the 1680s, 100 years before the American founding. Locke combines this classical idea of natural law, back to Cicero, with a biblical defense of natural rights. He does that in his two treatises of government. And when he talks about rights, natural rights, Locke means life, liberty, and property. Life, liberty, and property. And by property, Locke means much more than our material possessions. He means every good thing that we produce from the work of our hands and the creativity of our minds. So it's a broad understanding of property. What does Locke do? He draws from Cicero. He draws from the scriptures to argue that every person is born, quote, equal and independent. The workmanship, that's a word he uses, the workmanship of one omnipotent, infinitely wise maker, all the servants of one sovereign master, sent into the world by his order about his business. They are his property, Locke says, right? Created, called, sent by God into the world, a divine calling that must be respected by the political authority, by the government, because we're God's workmanship. That's a phrase, by the way, he lifts from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Locke knows his audience, his Christian audience, and he knows his Bible. Here is a biblical basis for human freedom and political equality. So the fundamental purpose of government for John Locke is the equal protection of our natural rights, regardless of race, creed, class. And any government that fails to protect our fundamental rights, according to Locke, forfeits its legitimacy and, quote, puts itself at war with the people. That's why Locke's second treatise of government is like a secular Bible to the American revolutionaries. Puts itself at war with the government. Western civilization is turning another corner. Like nowhere else in the world, friends, the foundation for liberal democracy, for government by consent of the governed, is now being set. And it's the inspiration for the most consequential campaign for human freedom, in half a millennium. Colonial Americans were educated in the political canon of the West, right? They learned the lessons of ancient Greece and ancient Rome, right? They studied the writings of Aristotle, Cicero, Plutarch, and the gang, yeah? And they invoked the protections of the Magna Carta, the English Bill of Rights. Their revolution was Lockean, John Lockean, to the core. They were fluent in the language of natural rights, but also in the language of the Bible. And I think that's one of the reasons we have such a majesty, a kind of linguistic majesty in the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they're endowed by the Creator with certain unalienable rights, right? Life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. Well, that's the American thing. How about the French thing? How about that French thing? The French Revolution of 1789, though inspired by the Revolution of 1776, collapses into violence and tyranny. Why? It's a complicated question. There are many reasons for the failure of the French Revolution, but chief among them is this. The architects of this revolution, the Jacobins, they swept away, friends, all of the norms, virtually all of the norms and traditions upon which Western civilization had been built, including the teachings of the Bible. They deny the tragic dimension to human nature, the doctrine of the fall. And they tried to implement a utopian vision of political life. They called it the dawn of universal bliss. How's that working out for you? Dawn of universal bliss, a vision that leads, of course, to the guillotine and the reign of terror. I love picking on the French. Why? Because they're the French. I pick on the Italians too. So you have French ancestry. I apologize. All right, great. All right. Well, the Americans are taking a different line here. The Americans at Philadelphia in 1787, they got a different idea of this. They assume the stubbornness of sin and the will to power. They assume it's going to be a problem, right? And they view factions, what we might call tribalism, they view factions as being sown in the nature of man and considered factions the mortal disease of self-government. The French aren't thinking about factions. They think everybody's going to come together, hold hands, and share precious promises. The founders don't think that way at all. So what do? They design a form of government, the American founders, that could manage human ambition and passion while still preserving individual freedom. Listen to Madison on this. It is vain to say that enlightened statesmen will be able to adjust these clashing interests and render them all subservient to the public good. Enlightened statesmen, Madison says, will not always be at the helm. Can I get an amen? Thank you. Thank you, church. Thank you. The miracle at Philadelphia is to produce a constitution in which the entire structure of government is designed to protect rights, the rights and freedoms proclaimed in the Declaration, separation of powers, federalism, etc. The whole structure of the Constitution is taking account of human nature. They gave us a republic, if we can keep it. This was a new idea in the history of ideas, right? Yes, friends, I am perfectly aware as an historian that the scourge of slavery was deeply embedded in the American experiment. It was not eradicated by the founders of Philadelphia. I get that. However, the Declaration and the Constitution together, like no other political documents on the globe, put the institution of slavery on notice all over the world. Its days would be numbered. And that is why I believe leaders like Abraham Lincoln, Frederick Douglass, and the Reverend Martin Luther King, they praised these founding documents as what? Promissory notes. Promissory notes for a government based on human equality and human freedom. As Dr. King put it, the goal of America is freedom. The goal of America is freedom. So this combination of political and religious doctrines, the bond between natural law and natural rights, between reason and revelation, this has produced, I would argue, the most successful democratic revolution in history. No, not New York. America remains the indispensable nation in the West, right? Still indispensable. Think about the influence of American and Western ideas around the globe in the adoption of free market economies, in education, in science, in medicine, in the concept of self-government. The norms of the West have become the norms of the world. Even the autocrats and the dictators in China, North Korea, Russia, they claim to govern by what? The consent of the governed. They claim, right? In his book, Civilization, the West and the Rest, British historian Neil Ferguson, he observes that the dominance of Western culture over the last 500 years is a stunning historical development that demands an explanation. The dominance of the West over other cultures over the last 500 years. Listen to Ferguson. It's the story at the very heart of modern history, he says. It is perhaps the most challenging riddle historians have to solve. Now, I don't pretend to have solved the riddle, but I want to emphasize one element in the story. Virtually every advance in the West owes some debt to the influence of the Bible. I have suggested something of this influence in the scientific and the political revolutions that have shaped the West, right? I want to draw attention to one more aspect of this influence before we close. I'm talking now about the central teaching of the Bible, right? The concept of a loving God on a rescue mission for mankind. A loving God on a rescue mission for mankind. This idea has inspired, I think, virtually every significant step toward a more just and humane society. And we've all but forgotten how this belief has so thoroughly transformed our civilization. You know, I took a trip to a little island off of Naples where my grandfather was born, Giuseppe Aiello, Giuseppe Joseph, for whom I'm named. He left Ventoden in 1921, 17 years old. Went to the island of Ventoden. It's about 400 to 500 people on the island. I'm related to half of them. I'm on my best behavior. So I'm hanging out in the piazza just to prove that I was over there. Hang on. Just to prove I was there. Okay, just to prove. Okay. All right, I was there. Hanging out in the piazza with the kids of Ventoden. And by late afternoon, by 3 o'clock or so, right till midnight, the children of Ventoden take over the piazza. The parents, the grandparents, the aunts, the uncles, they're all sitting around watching the kids play. They're playing cards, they're playing soccer, they're playing tag, right? So I'm watching a little group of them, and one of these kids, they're playing tag, and one little boy has a limp, something wrong with his leg. One leg is like a little shorter than the other, and he's limping along trying to keep up. And then you hear this from the other kids, Eduardo, andiamo, vieni qua. Eduardo is part of the game. He isn't excluded. He isn't left out to die as he would have been if he'd been born in ancient Greece or ancient Rome. He's welcome in the little community. He's brought in. This is what the message of the Bible has done for our civilization. It has civilized it, friends. It's civilized it. Think about it. Every person has value because every person bears the image of the Creator. God's on a rescue mission for humanity, we are told, a mission of forgiveness and redemption. And the effects of this message on our culture are so ubiquitous, we no longer appreciate their impact. Well, we're still in baseball season here. And let me just offer an example. Some of us are still in baseball season. And even if you hate baseball, you'll appreciate the story, I think. True story. We're in the Atlanta ballpark, May 17th, 2021. The Braves are playing my beloved and hapless New York Mets. Hapless and hopeless, I have to say. And Kevin Pillar, the outfielder, he's at the plate. He's facing the Braves, the pitcher, Jacob Webb, seventh inning of the game. Webb throws a 94.5-mile-per-hour fastball, hits him in the face. I've never seen it happen before. I saw it live. It was horrifying. Pilar's on the ground, blood everywhere, but he's okay. He's okay, but of course he's out of the game. He's off the field. He's forced out of regular play for several weeks to recover from his injuries. When he returns to the Mets ball club, he soon faces that same pitcher again, Jacob Webb, for the first time since the encounter in Atlanta. So all of the buzz in baseball is, what's going to happen in this next meeting between the Mets and the Braves? The body language. Is it going to be an encounter, a confrontation? The mood, friends, the mood at the stadium is tense and electric. Kevin Pillar steps up to the plate. He looks at Jacob Webb. He tips his hat and he nods. Jacob Webb looks back at Kevin Pillar, touches his hat and nods. There is no blood feud. There is no retribution. There is no rioting. The past is done, and they have a job to do, and that job is baseball. It's their calling and their craft. Friends, we got a name for this, a word for this. It's called civility. Civility. In our age of rage, we have nearly forgotten how important this quality is in our political life. How did our civilization generate this kind of civility? So that it still permeates at least some of our institutions. The answer, I think, at least part of the answer, is the Bible. From Genesis to the book of Revelation, the incredible value that God places on every human soul, the influence of the Bible has made the West the most decent and just and humane civilization in the history of the world. It's the place where forgiveness is possible, a place of refuge and welcome to the foreigner and to the least of these. And I say this with deep regret. Forces on the political left and on the hard right, the modern day Jacobins, they've forgotten this profound truth about our civilization. They've forgotten that the Bible is the story of God's love for the lost, for the losers, for the undeserving. You know, when Jesus wanted to communicate something about the love of God, he told three parables, three stories, right? Story of the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son, the prodigal son. Here, friends, in the West, like nowhere else in the ancient world, the individual stands at the center of divine love. Here, in the words of C.S. Lewis, we encounter the weight of glory, the staggering significance of every human life. This concept, I believe, has been the inspiration behind the most brilliant and noblest achievements of our civilization in politics, art, music, philosophy, literature, the humanities. But the biblical teaching is not only about man's worth, of course, it's also about man's shame, his fall from grace. The God of the universe entered into human history, into our civilization on a rescue mission because we needed rescuing. Our God is a God who saves, declares the psalmist. From the sovereign Lord comes escape from death. Think about it. The narrative arc of the Bible, it's a story of rescue, isn't it? God saves his chosen people, the Jews, from the slavery of Egypt, brings them into the freedom of the promised land, and then he goes on another rescue mission. Becoming a man, bleeding for Adam's helpless race. His very name, Jesus, means the Lord saves. So whatever you might personally think about Jesus, he stands at the center of world civilization. Listen to Albert Einstein on this. I am a Jew, he confesses, but I am captivated by the luminous figure of the Nazarene. Of all the civilizations in human history, it is the civilization of the West that has been transformed by the life and the teachings of the Nazarene. So, the obligation to redeem the lost, to protect the weak, to resist evil, these are the moral obligations, friends, that have sustained our civilization, especially at moments of crisis. And this brings us back to that crisis moment, June 1940. This is a moment when the Democratic West, still committed to the biblical concept of universal human rights, the West is fighting for its life. When Winston Churchill rises to address the House of Commons, the Nazis are determined to subjugate or destroy Great Britain. Their aim is to impose their racist utopian vision upon the entire continent of Europe. Almost no one in the United States, including the American president, seems to grasp what is happening. In 1940, Britain is alone. Britain is alone. Britain is the only force that stands between fascism and the dark twilight of Western civilization. And now the Battle of Britain is about to begin. Let's listen to a few words from Winston Churchill.
What General Wagon called the Battle of France is over. I expect that the Battle of Britain is about to begin. Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization. Upon it depends our own British life and the long continuity of our institutions and our empire. The whole fury and might of the enemy must very soon be turned on us. Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be free, and the life of the world may move forward into broad, sunlit uplands. But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us, therefore, brace ourselves to our duties and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say this was their finest hour.
Well, Great Britain by itself could not have won the war against Nazi Germany. It could not have. But think about it. Britain could have lost the war. They could have lost. And what would that have meant for the future of freedom in the West? No Normandy invasion, no D-Day. By standing firm, by being willing to sacrifice everything to resist evil, the British people bought for the West the most precious gift possible. They bought us time, friends, time. Time to find our courage before it was too late. It's a sobering thing to remember that fascism, a disease of the mind, originated from within our civilization, not from outside, from within, like a parasite. It sought to destroy the moral foundations of the West. And now, today, the West confronts new forms of disorder, ladies and gentlemen, new dreams of a utopian future, new forms of perverted science, new assaults on biblical religion. And once again, they're coming from within our civilization. So here's the question. Can we stand up to them? Do we have the courage? Do we care enough not only about the soul of the West, but about the soul of our neighbor? What are we prepared to do? We could begin, and we can all do this, we can begin by remembering. The discipline of memory is the gateway to gratitude. In Western civilization, we have inherited the most egalitarian, the most dynamic, the most prosperous, the most welcoming society in the history of the world. We need to remember what we've achieved and what it's cost us to preserve it. Otherwise, we can't defend it. And it needs defending, friends. Our civilization needs defending. And neutrality, as we've seen historically, neutrality is not an option. We are called, each of us, to become part of the resistance. The resistance. If there is a loving God at the heart of the universe, then we need to commit ourselves to his cause in our own time, in our own place. You know, I think all of us, we strive for the good of the city of man, even as we long to live in the city of God, in the far-off country. A cleft has opened in the pitiless walls of the world, wrote C.S. Lewis, and we are invited to follow our great captain inside. May all of us find the strength and the courage to follow him wherever he leads, because the fate of our neighbor and our civilization may depend on it. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Joe. Hello. Thank you, Joe. There we go. We do have time for a few questions. And if you would use the mic, Rebecca has one here. I have one right here. Dennis.
Yeah, Professor, I'd be interested in your thoughts about like the next act for America. Are we about the only civilization ever constituted that could create its own race?
Constituted. Say it again.
The only civilization in the history, because of our governance and our beliefs, that can create its own race.
Create its own race?
Race, R-A-C-E.
I'm not sure I understand.
The American race. Everybody coming together into
one. Oh, okay, people. A community, a political community.
Go ahead.
Oh, Joe. I'll take a stab at it. It's a great question. It does seem to me what the Americans did, what we did in Philadelphia, was to say, okay, here's a vast republic, not a democracy in the Greek sense. Here's a vast republic, representative government, based not on race, on a racial demographic, on a religious creed, on ethnic background, but based on a set of ideas, a philosophical set of ideas about the nature of human nature, the dignity of the individual, the concept of freedom, a set of political, philosophical, and even religious ideas, you could argue. That's the first time that ever happened in the history of mankind. And not only is it this proclamation, they then try to embody that in a constitution. That is a unique thing. And I think it's been a great source of strength for the United States. You come to the United States, as my grandparents did, leaving fascist Italy in the 1920s and 30s, leaving fascist Italy, coming to the United States, not because there were a lot of Italians living in Brooklyn at the time, though there were a few, and there were more of them the family got there, but because of this idea of freedom, this idea of freedom and the worth of the individual. That was a new thing on the landscape, on the whole historical landscape. Thank you for that question.
Right over here. Yes.
Professor Francis Fuqua, the famous professor, said that the end of history had occurred. We're no longer going to have an argument between communism and capitalism. Do you think there is a continued history and still a battle for the thoughts and ideas of the political economy?
Yes, we're still having debates. And Francis Fukuyama, try to be fair to Fukuyama, this is after the collapse of the Soviet Union, the end of the Cold War. He said, well, look, the big ideological fights are over now. Cold War is over. And democracy should just reign. It should just kind of take over the globe. He kind of predicted this progressive growth of democracy. Well, it hasn't quite turned out that way, has it? Not only threats external to the United States, like say a China or a Russia, but also, and this is the focus of my talk, I guess today, is internal threats. Challenges to the whole idea of the Western tradition, the classical liberal tradition. We're in a period of great self-doubt that I don't think we've quite seen, maybe, because I've been doing some work on this recently, maybe not since the 1920s and early 30s, after the First World War. There was a great period of self-doubt in Europe, less so in the United States. But the trauma of the First World War created incredible doubts about Western civilization in Europe. We're going through a similar period like that right now. Great question.
Rebecca. Oh, yes, sir.
I think you essentially said this, but let me say it and see if you want to elaborate. It seems to me, particularly the far left wants to say, because our founders weren't perfect, it shows that the system they created isn't perfect.
Yeah,
I think it's just the opposite. And I'm wondering, it's because they were aware how imperfect they were. They wanted the system to protect against those types of imperfections.
Yes.
And I was wondering what you might have to say about that.
Yes, thank you. It's a terrific question. You know, the famous line from Madison, if men were angels, no government would be necessary. This is the starting place for thinking. There's a line from Abraham Lincoln. Of course, he said the Declaration of the Constitution informed all of his political thinking, right? Lincoln once said this. I'm paraphrasing, but it's pretty close. He says, the Bible says somewhere that mankind is desperately wicked. And then pause. And then Lincoln says, I think I would have discovered that fact without the Bible. Yeah, baby. Look in the mirror. The American founders were so sober about human nature, not only our potential for self-government, but our potential for self-destruction. They understood human nature. And I think that's part of the biblical influence. The founders were in different places in their religious beliefs, but they all really believed in the fall of man at some level. The French don't. That's a problem. Now it plays into your constitution. Are you going to have a constitution that respects not only the capacity, but the limitations of human nature or not? The Americans say we are. Separation of powers, federalism, enumerated powers, amendments, the whole thing, right? And it sustained us pretty well. But the institutions, the constitution's not enough, right? We need men and women, especially the next generation, but you guys too, men and women of virtue who care about the common good. And the founders never imagined that the Constitution would be enough by itself. You've got to cultivate virtue. That's the education task. That's why Loconte is still breathing, doing what he's doing, trying to get to the next generation. Yeah, great question, thanks.
Is it unique to have the documents that we have at the apex of the structure, like the Constitution, Declaration of Independence? And is that unique in history to have those documents above the executive branch and the other branches?
Yes, I think it is. I mean, I would say, I'll qualify it a bit in saying, look, the Greeks developed their own documents about, as the democracy is evolving, they're developing documents, but it's kind of coming after the fact. The Romans, borrowing some from the Greeks, they're developing their system of a republic, right? A Senate. We will borrow some ideas from the Romans, but it's a new thing to sit down at a convention in Philadelphia on a long, hot summer and to deliberate and to debate rationally, calmly, and to compromise. And they had to make a number of compromises, didn't they, in Philadelphia. That was a new thing, the most deliberative political body the world has ever seen. And I want to add, the founders, to a person, they had a grasp of history. They had a grasp of what had come before. Why did the Greek democracy system fail? Why did Rome fail? The founders knew the reasons. They could recite them to you. That was a new thing. Great question. Thank you for that.
One more question over here, Rebecca.
Your talk was excellent. I really enjoyed it. Thank you. But it seems to me that your brief is incomplete. One of Thomas Sowell's questions is always, compared to what? What were the other civilizations doing in the 17th and 18th centuries when the West was engaged in the Enlightenment and all the wonderful things that you talked about?
Excellent question. I wish we had another couple of days to tackle that. I was hoping for a yes-no question, but I guess we just weren't going to get that. No, it's a great question. It's a great question. And I'm not a professor of comparative civilizations. I do tend to focus, so I'm a bit out of my depth. But let me just think about this for a second, because I haven't been asked that question before. What's going on, say, in the Middle East, 18th century, what's 19th, 18th century, what's going on in China, 18th century? I think you could argue there's a lot of, the one thing that Madison and the founders feared, there's a lot of tribalism. There's a lot of factions and infighting. And they don't have anything like constitutions, political constitutions, to try to order their political life. What is it? It's based on the strongman, the chieftain, the emperor, right? Nothing like government by consent of the governed. It's not happening in those other civilizations. Not happening in Asia. Not happening in Russia. Not happening in Africa, in the continent of Africa. So the whole idea of government by consent, that's why I spent so much time on the natural law and natural rights thing. That's how you get government by consent of the governed, because people have these natural, universal, God-given rights that government has to respect. And for different reasons, I don't fully understand. Other civilizations didn't develop this idea of natural, God-given rights. If you have that idea in your head, then you got to think, well, what do I do to protect them? What kind of a political society can protect them? But that's what the founders are thinking long and hard about in the 18th century. But not in China, not in Russia. Not in the Middle East. It's the will to power, it's tribalism, it's chiefs, it's emperors, it's kings. It's not government by consent. It's a great gift we have. We don't want to squander it. Thank you for that question.
Ladies and gentlemen, please thank Joe Loconte. Joe, thank you.
Thank you, Joe.
We look forward to seeing everyone.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. We look forward to seeing you at all at our great programs this coming fall. Enjoy the rest of your evening at Liberty Hill, and thank you again.
Thanks for coming.